And thanks for the opportunity to speak here. This is a bit odd, isn't it? So, John Norton talked this morning about the passive consumer. And yet, you're sitting here in this auditorium, passively consuming, arguably, in many cases. Did you make a choice about the speakers here? I mean, you might want to avoid my talk and see the other two. You might want to stay at home and wait for the recordings to come out. It might be easier. And there's no necessary need for me to be here either. As it happens, I am. But the point I want to make is that in a world where it's possible to connect people easily in an asynchronous way, you don't necessarily need to make the choice to be here to get the whole story. So this is the title of my talk, and I'll explain what I mean as I'm going along. This is the other title for my talk, and I'll also explain that a little later as well. Hopefully this will all become clear. But I want to sort of thank a few people before I start. I think one of the important things to realise about science is that we always build on the work of others, and actually our contributions are often a lot smaller than we like to think they are. So all of these people have all contributed to these ideas, as have these people, some of whom are in the audience, and also these people. It makes a bit of a mockery of the Englefinger rule, amongst other things. But enough about them, let's talk about me instead. So I finished high school in 1990. So this was an interesting time to be a teenager. I actually had one of these computers, an Amiga 500. Some of you may find that familiar. We also had that printer. We didn't have the hard drive. That is a 20 megabyte hard drive. That was really exciting. The kid down the road had one of those. He ended up working for Google. Just goes to show. I did my undergraduate from 1991 to 1994, and the thing I wanted to pick out here was this quote. It was my first introduction to doing research, and this was said without irony and accepted by me without irony. The notion that you could go to the library once a week, spend about half a day, and read all the new journals that had arrived in a given subject area. That dates me. I started my PhD in 1995. And 1995 was a really interesting year in universities. It was the year that the web sort of started to make its presence felt in the university sector. I actually started handcrafting HTML web pages with those lovely grey backgrounds, not really having any awareness of what this meant apart from the fact that I could put up a home page, and that was really quite exciting for me. A little while later, you start to see journals appearing online in some form or other. Sometimes there were articles, sometimes there were just abstracts. Things moved along and they changed a lot as PubMed, which had existed as this CD that you could go to the library and then book a computer and then put it in and then do a search that was 3 months out of date. I lived in Australia, so everything was at least 3 months out of date. This meant I could access all the relevant literature for my research from my desk in the lab on the computer that was sat there. And that was a very big change. And of course, then Google came along and actually made the web work by enabling you to actually search for things that you were looking for. So the bottom line is that when I started my PhD, there was a world that would be familiar to many of you, where you went to the library once a week as a researcher to find out what was new. It was the place you had to go to get the information you needed. And over the course of those 5 years, it changed to it being a search box accessible from the computer on my desk. The world had utterly changed. So that means I am the last generation to actually remember the library as the place where you go to find all information. That will make no sense to the students that I train today. That concept is completely gone. I'm the last generation to really think of a journal as a paper thing that has covers. No one actually looks at those anymore. You may deliver them to the libraries, but in the UK at least, most of them is them being parked out to departments because they have to do it, because otherwise they have to pay the VAT on the digital edition. And then at some point when they're allowed to, they're being pulped. And I'm certainly the last generation to actually imagine going back to those paper indexes and searching through, physically looking for things. Chemical abstracts, great experience every week. So who are you? Where are you coming from? So there's obviously, I'm expecting that basically there's a division here. We have the publishers on this side and the librarians on that side. Is that fair? So I'm not going to try and characterise you all as one group, except to say that there's a series of challenges and issues with information delivery, information access, that you're the people who have to deliver on those requirements for research and for education. And that on top of that, particularly in the current challenging climate, you're also in a position where you have to add value. And so the question is, of course, how are you adding value? Are you passively sitting in the auditorium? Or are you blogging, tweeting, taking notes, reporting back? So I can be confrontational, I can argue about all the things that you're doing wrong, but it's probably more productive, it's usually more productive, to start with what we have as shared issues, shared problems. So I think we definitely share a problem, and that's this. There is just too much stuff out there. Phil showed his email inbox. I hate to think how much is actually in there, but you know, I've never seen anyone. I know, every scientist I know subscribes to electronic table of contents. I don't know anyone who actually reads them. But my wife has 1,500 unread emails in that email inbox. And we have too little resource to deal with that. So this is a multitude of information, of data, but we have too little resource to deal with it. And for some of us, for me in particular, that resource is time. I simply don't have the time to go through and find out what's important. For some of you, that resource is money. You don't have the people, the infrastructure, the money to deal with all of the information that you could possibly deal with. So we have, in the words of Clay Shirky, a classic case of information overload. We are blessed by living in the most information-rich environment the human race has ever known, but we're not really coping very well. And of course, what Clay Shirky goes on to say is that this is not, in fact, about information overload. We've had information overload pretty much since writing was invented, since communication was invented. The last person who could have read all of the books that existed at any point in history probably died around about 400 AD. So the problem is one of filters. So he speaks that it's not information overload, it's filter failure. And I want to argue that that's not a good frame for us to think about it. I think there's a much better way to think about this problem. That's what I'm going to go through. So why do I disagree with the notion of filter failure? And the point is that filters block stuff. They block light. Now, you as the people who have to add value are sitting there thinking, yeah, that's a really good thing. Because that's what we do. We block out all that stuff that no one wants. We act as the gatekeeper and make sure that only the important stuff is getting through. That's how we're adding value. You're protecting the research community, the educational community, the health community, the patient community from a deluge of stuff that they can't deal with. You're helping us keep on the straight and narrow by making sure standards are applied. And I would argue that actually what you're doing is making decisions that limit my ability to do my scholarship. You're not allowing me to make those decisions. You have taken that power away from me. Filters block. What if I want to measure the light, natural spectrum coming through there, and you haven't told me what exactly the filter is blocking? What about the other uses of this information? Are you providing the right filter for me? Are you providing the right filter for me as I need it at this moment in time? Do I have the choice to reconfigure it? And you already know this. How many of you have actually cracked open an encyclopedia in the last 10 years? Physically opened up a book. Reference. So, very brave person, 2-3 people, okay? So it's about 5%, and that's about the number of hands I get whenever I ask that question. Which one of those is the highly curated, highly validated reference source? And which is the one that's actually providing you with the information you need? On Google, you can reconfigure, you can set the filter to be what you want, within the limitations, obviously, that Google allow you. In your journals, whether they're the journals you publish or the journals you have in your library that I have access to, that filter is hidden away from me and I have no control over it whatsoever. So let me give you an example of that. This is a paper. Anyone from American Chemical Society here? Good, they're not admitting it. David Martinson hates me for using this example, but it's not a particularly an ACS problem, to be fair. This is a paper that appeared in JAX about a year and a half ago. It was notionally an extremely important paper. It showed something that was really surprising. Basically, it showed that black was white. You'd expect this to be very carefully tested, the peer review to be checking these extraordinary claims and that extraordinary evidence was provided, and of course that was not the case at all. What actually happened is that within about 12 hours of the paper going live, about 5 people worldwide had tried to repeat the experiment. They identified the fact that the experimental results were correct, but they resulted from a contaminant in the reagent rather than it actually being the reaction that was proposed in the paper. So the paper was then fairly quickly retracted for scientific reasons. Now what does that mean? So here is a filter has been applied to make this paper available to me. That filter has then been applied again to take that paper away from me. And the only information I have is that it's been retracted for scientific reasons. Even though this reaction could be useful, even if I'm interested in the results, I know nothing now about the experimental validity of the results, how they were done. What can I trust? What was the problem with this paper? The only way I can find that information is by going back to Google, because they're the people who are indexing it. They're the people who help me find what I'm looking for if I need it. There's a much more effective way of getting to the problem. I can multiply examples. This is not the ACS. There was arsenic microbes, genome-wide association studies with aging, reactomes. There have been dozens of examples of this over the last 12 to 18 months where a peer-reviewed paper in a highly prestigious journal has been knocked down in about 24 hours by people who should have been reviewing it before it went live. But actually, bits of those papers are useful. There's nothing wrong with them, it's just that the conclusions are wrong, or that the analysis is wrong. There still might be something that I would find valuable out of that. And it's getting a lot worse. So this is a graph of retractions. This is not retractions in total, this is retractions per 100,000 papers. If you extrapolate that, somewhere around about 20, 25, every single paper is going to be retracted, which is problematic. The point is that the filter that you are applying, and the filter that you're applying whether you are the journal running the peer review process or the collections manager deciding which journals I get to read, has failed me. It's crude, it's binary, and it's inappropriate for a lot of the scholarship that I want to do. The reason we have this system is because we needed to have the gatekeeper. We needed to have the gatekeeper because printing was expensive, distribution was expensive, and it made sense to centralize it. Made, past tense, sense, to centralize it. Those decisions had to be made because limited resources had to be applied, limited resources of money, materials, space, shelving. Today, the world is an entirely different place. There is a fire hose of information coming out. And there's not a whole lot you can do about it. If you do try and block it, it's going to come at you from the other direction anyway. So your notion that you're protecting the quality of information by blocking things is actually pretty misguided. You've got all of this information and it's coming from all directions. And I want to tell you that's a good thing. This is the central research opportunity of our age. So many of you librarians have a library science background. Ranganathan's laws are perhaps the most general and continuously valid set of principles I have ever come across in my life, at least in terms of social principles of management and arrangement. And this third law, this notion that every book has its reader, every book, every single piece of information out there has a valid place to go, has someone who could use it. And today it is technically feasible to actually connect all of those pieces to the potential users. All we actually need to do is connect them up. All, I say, as though it's easy. If you're just standing in front of the fire hose, you're not adding any value. If all you are doing is taking a bunch of content in and blocking some of it, and then sticking the rest of it behind a wall, and I don't care whether it's a paywall or a brick wall, you're not adding any value. You can still make money without adding value, but it's not a stable system. So the point I want to make is it's not filter failure. We shouldn't be thinking about providing centralized filters for the research community, for the wider information economy. We should be talking about enabling discovery. It's not filter failure. It's actually a deficit in our ability to discover what we want at a given point in time. So if the previous ship stuck in ice, it's actually the discovery, it's a New Zealand boat in Antarctica, represents our current ability to actually find what we're looking for on the wider web of data, knowledge and information. Is the icebreaker of Google the answer, the simple search paradigm? And it's part of the answer. Search is a critical part of making the web work. But it's a blunt instrument, and not every problem is a nail, obviously. So is there an answer? I think there are a whole series of answers. There are a whole series of interesting ways to approach the problem of enabling discovery. But I just want to give one example of one approach that I think sort of illustrates the wider point about network systems. So I showed you this graph, and no one objected to it. No one questioned it. No one wondered where I got the numbers from. I did, in fact, cite its source. So this is data that comes from a GitHub repository. But what's the motivation behind this? Where did it come from? And actually, it's all Jeff Builder's fault. Now, I don't even know whether he's even aware of this, but he asked a question. In fact, I don't know that he even asked. Did he ask the question? Yes. So he's bookmarked someone else's blog post about retractions. And what happens then is that's pulled into another service. It gets shared amongst a group of people. And someone goes off and answers that question in 24 hours. It's easy. Turns out to be very simple to get the information to actually build that graph from PubMed. So there's a system of aggregation, of discovery of the information, actually finding the right person to answer the question. And all of this has happened automatically by linking a series of standardized frameworks, standardized platforms for information transfer into a set of social systems. So remember these people. They're all the ones that are sitting there primed to help you filter, distribute, aggregate, move, identify, discover information. By providing standardized platforms through which that information can flow, RSS is the simplest and broadest of those. RSS is not dead, it's just disappearing underneath all the tools that everyone is using. I can aggregate a very wide amount of information into one place, and I can use other people to help me discover the information that's crucial to me. And it doesn't have to just be papers. It can be tweets, it can be ideas, it can be samples, it can be pictures, it can be presentations and videos, all of these things. So we have social aggregation as a mechanism of discovery. We also have social annotation because when people interact with these objects, these questions, these pieces of data, they leave a trace. And those traces, those metrics, those pieces of information help to tell me whether I should be paying attention to this or not. They help me, again, to discover what I need, even though I didn't know it. This actually came up about 2 weeks before I gave this talk for the first time. And it just popped up when I was thinking, what's the example I need? Oh, here it is. So we have social annotation, but we also have, as Phil has mentioned, so we have social critique. This is peer review happening live. But we also have the entire workflow preserved here as part of the process. it's all there. And not only is it all there, it's actually linked together in a network, again, like Phil showed, which is then primed for the still the most effective discovery engine on the planet, which is Google, to find it for me. So the networks, the network data, the aggregation platforms pull all of this together. This is not the whole solution, and it's not perfect, and it's a long way from solving all of those problems. But it's an indication of what can be done in particular areas. So each of these interactions adds value. Each of these interactions measures the value to me. And because I've configured the network of people, the network of systems, I've made the choices about the filters that are applied there. I'm adding pieces to my collection. I'm indexing and curating the collections of things, the objects, the pieces of information that are coming to me. You notice that one? It's my collection. Daniel Chudnow has this wonderful quote that he says, "I see my job as enabling my users to build their own collections." My laptop sitting down there can probably take more content than some of your libraries. It's not about centralizing anymore. They're my filters. They're not the filters you're providing. If you can provide me filters that I can choose to use, that's a very different question. That's a useful service. But I need the choice about which filters I'm applying. So what does this mean you can actually do? I've perhaps been a little bit challenging. What are we actually going to do about it? In general terms, the point I would make, and the analogy of graphs keeps coming up, and it keeps coming up advisedly, because this is the way we can tackle and connect a lot of this information up. If you connect information, you connect people. You think about not how you stop something becoming public, but how you connect the right person with that content. You think about how you can connect the content you have together with the content that other people have together, then you can add a great deal of value. And yes, that raises some issues around access rights. Sorry. But above all, the thing that's really going to make these systems work, if we can get these things working well, is to connect people with each other so that they can enable themselves to build discovery networks and discovery systems. So the gatekeeper is very definitely dead. There is too much information. We can only manage it together with all of us. So enable access, enable people to discover things. Don't block, don't toss in the garbage bin. Build platforms that enable people to do things and take information and take it where they want to and use it in the way they want to. Don't build destinations. By sell, I don't necessarily mean sell for money, but provide the services to your customers, whether they're members of your institution or the people paying for services downstream. The content game's dead. Sorry. Don't think about filtering, and don't think about control over what's happening, because that will prevent other people doing discovery. But if you enable discovery, then we stand the chance of actually taking what is the biggest opportunity we've ever had in terms of managing and passing the information we have and doing something useful with it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions for Cameron? Got somebody coming down, I think, or leaving? Leaving. So I have a question, Cameron. Do you see any examples of publishers who are enabling rather than blocking?
I think actually, you know, most publishers are making an effort in this space in one form or another. It's easy to point at PLOS with the Article 11 metrics program, the ability to retake and repass and remix data. It's equally easy to talk about BMC and what they're doing with data in particular, and trying to expand out of the simple paper space. But I think a lot of publishers are making an effort. I think the question is, how do we make those efforts more effective and more combinable together? And that's the critical problem. I think we're still feeling our way, to be honest. You know, Nature Publishing Group did a lot of exploratory work, which arguably didn't, in the end, turn out to really change the world. Equally, the work Elsevier have done on the Article of the Future looks forward, but we have to figure out how to actually take those things to the next level now.
Okay, last chance for questions. Do we have a question back there? If you want to come down to the microphone here. You just say who you are, and then thank you.
Hi, I'm Laura Patterson from Annual Reviews. I was wondering if you think researchers still do not want a filter if they know it's a trusted source, such as PubMed, you know, if they start their searches there. I mean, PubMed doesn't index every single STM journal, and so they are going to be missing some content. So what do you think?
So there are two answers to that question. I think most researchers actually don't think about this all that much, to be honest. They see a problem where they don't find something. So mostly when I talk to people, it's the, oh, I couldn't find it in PubMed, I was reduced to using Google Scholar. And then when you start talking to people about what different indexes actually cover, they get very uncomfortable about what they're missing. Because I mean, this is the great fear, is that you're going to miss the thing that's important for you to know, that you do the experiment that you shouldn't have done or don't do the experiment you should have done. So I think there's a growing awareness that these systems are imperfect, and there's certainly a desperation amongst researchers to find ways of managing that incoming information more efficiently. Most people would like to see less coming in. I think there's an awful lot of e-tables of contents, you know, there's a lot of stuff there that you don't really want to read. So how do I efficiently figure out which of these things I actually really do need to read, is the critical question. And I think at that point people will start thinking much more carefully about configuring the filters they're using. So growing use of search terms on PubMed to generate RSS feeds, for instance. But that's still very, very crude. There's one down there.
Number three, Richard.
Hi. Maybe everyone's asleep. Because what I think you've just said is that, you know, and just kind of correct me if I'm wrong here, but what I think you've just said is that, you know, basically, well, in my mind, the internet is kind of pretty much awash with junk science. There's a whole load of crap out there. Fake science, you know, voodoo. And what you seem to be advocating is that publishers should just get a bit of the slice of that action.
So, sorry, excuse me. So the web is awash with junk. We know that 95% of what's on the web is junk. We also know that you can generally find what you're looking for within certain parameters and for certain types of content. Actually, the web is a pretty good place to find information. So I think there are two ways of framing response to your question. One is that I would say there is nothing wrong with publishers, academics, authorities labeling work that they see as trusted. So there's nothing wrong with a thing that we might call a journal that has within it stuff that's gone through a defined QA process that is transparent and that we understand, and that people can then choose to use that as a filter. The problem I have is actually the problem that Phil mentioned, is that I cannot be bothered publishing all the experiments that didn't work because it's just too much of a pain in the butt to go through the peer review process. There need to be mechanisms, to very low barrier mechanisms, to get that information out. I wasted £60,000 of government money repeating an experiment that seven people knew wouldn't work. Make that concrete. They couldn't be bothered publishing the fact that it didn't work because it was too much work. So we need to find a way of squaring that circle. So I think you can still mark up stuff, you can still validate, you can still trust, bookmark, and set up the trust relationships that you will work on. But what I'm saying is, don't block publication. Don't think about this as we must stop this fire hose of content making its way onto the web because it's already too late. What we need to do is find ways to channel the good stuff and mark it up and try and figure out how we make the good stuff that is useful more discoverable so that Google actually works for science.